నమస్కారం. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయ విద్యార్థులకు స్వాగతం.
టుడేస్ టాపిక్ ఫర్ డిస్కషన్ ఈజ్ కన్జ్యూమర్ బయింగ్ బిహేవియర్ అండ్ దిస్ టాపిక్ ఈజ్ సెలెక్టెడ్ ఫ్రమ్ ది కోర్స్ ఆర్ సబ్జెక్ట్ ప్రిన్సిపల్స్ ఆఫ్ మార్కెటింగ్ ఫర్ ది థర్డ్ ఇయర్ బీకామ్ స్టూడెంట్స్ ఆఫ్ డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ. యాజ్ వీ నో, టుడేస్ టాపిక్ ఫర్ ది డిస్కషన్ ఈజ్ కన్జ్యూమర్ బయింగ్ బిహేవియర్. దెన్ వాట్ ఈస్ కన్జ్యూమర్ బయింగ్ బిహేవియర్? బేసికలీ a manufacturer or a producer will do manufacturing the goods and services and also selling them into market. And before doing these two things, a marketer has to do what basically needs a consumer or a customer. Because unless the pulse of the consumers we know, a manufacturer cannot produce the goods whatever he likes. In this context, a manufacturer need to know that the study of consumer behavior in the prior basis. We have two subject experts along with me. They are Professor N.R.K. Reddy.
Hello.
Dean Sivashivani Institute of Management, Hyderabad. Next to him is T.V. Ramaraju, Department of Business Management, Pragati Mahavidyalaya, Hyderabad. Let me ask Professor N.R.K. Reddy to explain who is a consumer. Professor N.R.K. Reddy.
Yes, we need to understand first who is a consumer. A consumer is one who involves in the process of decision making, in acquiring information, in evaluating information and also disposition of goods and services. When you look at the consumer as a concept, a person who involves in the consumption of a product or service can be defined as a consumer. But here, a person merely consuming is not the a definition. But here there are certain other activities that are also involved before consumption comes into effect. That is basically, it's a decision making process. It's a physical process through which the consumer is making a decision and he is evaluating the information that is available to him through marketing intelligence. He covers a lot of sources and then gathers a lot of information. On the basis of this information, he makes a decision. Then after acquiring this, he need to choose, or after generating a lot of alternatives, you need to choose the best product. So after this, then he decides to consume a product. Therefore, the consumer is one who indulges in the activity of not only acquiring the information, not only making the decision, but also consumes. That is how the consumer is defined. So consumer, the definition is relatively, it has got a greater scope rather than simply consuming person who consumes the product. But in the earlier days, we used to consider only the consumers who are involving in the process of decision making, evaluating and all that in case of economic goods. Economic goods are those goods which are used in, which are purchased by paying some money and all that. But now, we are also incorporating certain free goods. For example, voluntary organizations also render some kind of free service. These free services also are included as a part of the consumer definition now. Therefore, not only economic goods that the people are consuming, even non-economic goods or free services are also included. Therefore, consumer is one who consumes economic goods and also the non-economic goods.
Thank you, Professor Reddy. Let me ask Ramaraju garu. So, how does a consumer different from a customer? Both are same or they are different? Please.
Professor Pawar, there is a difference between the two terms, customer and consumer. In fact, most of the times the two terms are used interchangeably, but we will try to understand the difference. As Dr. Reddy has rightly pointed out, a consumer is one who typically engages in evaluating, buying the product, taking the purchase decision, consuming the product and disposing of the product. Whereas a customer is one who actually buys the product. Customer is explained in terms of specific organization, whereas consumer is defined in terms of the product he consumes. Let me quote an appropriate example where we can clearly differentiate between these two terms. I can say customers of McDonald's, consumers of pizzas. Now, this way we can clearly understand. Two situations are wisely before us that help us understand the difference between customer and a consumer. The first situation is when the good is provided free of cost. Where the good is provided free of cost, where no money goes out of the a person's pocket, we should call him consumer but not a customer. An example is the consumers of government's midday meal program. We should not call them as customers. No, they are not customers. No money is going out of their pocket. They are just the beneficiaries. If I say customer, then he should perform, as Dr. Reddy has pointed out, the economic activity or an economic transaction. This is one situation that helps us understand the difference between these two. The second situation is a person who is buying the product is a customer.
Next, Professor N.R. Reddy, similarly, is there any difference between a buyer and a user?
Yes, there is a certain difference between the buyer and the consumer or user. Buyer is one who goes to the retail outlet and buys the product. And when we say the buyer is going to the, person and buying, to the seller and buying the product, we are talking about the exchange process. So, the buyer is related to the exchange process. When we talk about exchange process, exchange of good and in terms of cash, as against the cash. Now, I am paying money and in turn getting the commodity or service that I am wanting. Here, the process is very clear that there is only a transaction process. But it is not necessary that a person who is buying need not consume the same product. Yeah. So, the buyer is different, he may be buying for somebody's sake. And the consumer is one, he may not be the buyer, but he consumes because somebody else may be buying for him. So, in order to understand this, probably an example will make it very clear. Now, take an example of a small kid of 5-year-old and she pesters the mother that she wants a chocolate to go to the school. Unless you give me the chocolate, I will not go to the school. This is how the children behave. We all of us experience these kind of situations. Now, the mother pesters the husband to get a chocolate for the daughter. And then he goes to the nearby shop and then procure one chocolate for the daughter. By the time he comes home, the daughter doesn't accept this chocolate and she wants something else, some other chocolate. She is very particular about the brand of the chocolate that she consumes. So, finally, some other person will consume. So, look at this. The initiator is the daughter in the family with regard to the need and she wants to fulfill that need. And then the mother is influencing the husband to procure that chocolate for the daughter. Finally, she doesn't consume, but somebody else in the family consumes. Therefore, somebody else is the consumer, the buyer is the father, the initiator is the daughter, and the purchaser or the buyer is the father. I think with this we can understand the difference between the user and the buyer. So, buyers need not be the users, but it can happen always. It cannot happen always like that. But sometimes it so happens the buyers also may be the consumers. For themselves, they may buy sometimes.
Thank you, Reddy. So far, we distinguished or differentiated the concepts of consumer, customer, buyer and user. Now, we will know what is the concept of consumer behavior, Ram Rajukar.
Consumers exhibit certain behavior while taking a purchase decision, while shopping in a store, while discussing about the products, while providing feedback, while consuming the product, while disposing the products. In all these activities, consumers exhibit certain type of behavior. And this behavior varies from person to person.
Yeah.
Marketers would like to know, understand and predict this consumer behavior. The basic purpose is either marketers try to mold themselves according to the consumer behavior or they will try to influence the consumer behavior. Yeah. Now, in an attempt to study consumer behavior, marketers proceed forward with a discipline called consumer behavior. And in an attempt to that, they will try to find out answers for certain questions. And seven set of questions are given. I think a slide will help the audience to understand this. There are seven set of questions. The answers of all these questions start with letter O. Hence, this concept is known as 7 O's structure.
Yeah.
If we understand these questions and answers, That means we are trying to understand the consumer behavior in detail. Now, the first question, if you look at market constitutes of whom, that means who are there in the market. Marketer tries to know that there are consumers, buyers, users, influencers, gatekeepers, different persons playing different roles. All these people are there. Each person carrying his own entity and his own emphasis in the field of marketing. So, market tries to know the answer for this first question. Then if you look at the second question, what do these occupants buy? This is also very important for the marketers. These days, the answer is objects, that means goods and services. Due to increased utility of internet and computers, more of computers are being purchased. Westernization is motivating people to buy more fast food, more Western food, and more different types of dress material. So, a paradigm change has come in the objects that are consumed by the customers and purchased by the customers. So, that is tried to know in the second question. If you look at the third question in 7O structure, that is, why do people buy goods? The objectives, that is, the motives behind buying. People may buy goods because they need, because their needs, tastes, and preferences, because of the influence of society or culture. So, marketers would like to know why people buy goods. That means the objectives behind buying. Then the next question is, who will participate in buying? Organizations. That means families and business customers, they participate in buying. Marketers very clearly come about with different packages for customers, different packages for families as such. Family packs they will introduce. So, marketers would like to know who will participate in buying, the organizations and their nature of consumption. The next one is, how do the customers buy? That means operations, the way they buy. People are buying through different modes and means, the cash transactions, non-cash transactions, most of credit cards are used these days,
yeah.
Even to buy petrol and even small things like footwear. If I wanted to buy for my pretty daughter, I will use a credit card these days. And moreover, if you look at the mode of purchase, people are buying in pack. Earlier, atta, oil, people used to buy in loose, but now those products people are buying in packed form. So, the way people are buying the goods has changed very much. So, that is also very important. The next one, when will they buy? Marketers would like to know on which occasions customers buy products. Customers buy seasonal products during seasons, dress material, jewelry during marriage season and festivals and functions. They buy greeting cards during Valentine's Day and New Year's Eve and Christmas Eve. And also, we find people buying entertainment and fast food in the weekends.
Yeah.
All this is very, very important for the marketers. And finally, where do they buy? The outlets is the answer. That is also very important. The place of purchase has also changed a lot. People are increasingly showing inclination to buy at their doorsteps. Earlier, if I wanted to consume a burger, I had to go up to Pizza Hut or McDonald's. Of course, it is there here. So, I had to go up to the food house. But now, I can procure a pizza to my doorsteps. Now, this is what is consumer behavior.
Thank you, Mr. Raju, for giving 7O structure for understanding consumer behavior, what it is. And let me ask Professor Reddy, why do marketers need to study consumer behavior?
What is the role of a marketer first?
Yeah.
If you understand the role of a marketer and then if you understand the role of consumer behavior, then probably we'll be able to match it clearly. The role of a marketer is to identify the needs of the consumer. Every consumer has got his desires, needs, wants, and to fulfill these needs, to fulfill these wants, we need goods and services. And companies or organizations are indulging in the process of producing these commodities and services. So, the marketer's role is in the process of identifying the consumer needs, what type of the products are being liked by the consumers, what the consumer wants, how I can meet that requirement. This is the problem of a marketer. So, to understand the need of the consumer, the marketer or marketers are striving today. And sometimes the consumer behavior is so complex that, you know, consumer wants some product, but the organizations are not able to understand the actual need and how this can be fulfilled. Therefore, the marketers are interested in identifying the needs. And they also indulge in a kind of exchange process. Exchange process, when we say, how a good can be handed over to the consumer in order to satisfy his desires. This is basically exchange process. Now, this is the role of a marketer. Now, what is the role of a consumer and here? And the consumer behavior is very complex. It is not that easy to understand. Now, in the light of this, what we need to understand is how a consumer is behaving. So, the marketers need to study the consumer behavior. If they know in certain situation, as Mr. Ramraj was rightly mentioning, why do they buy, what do they buy, when do they buy, how do they buy, where do they buy, these are the questions that Professor Ramraj was trying to answer these questions. Marketers need to understand the consumer's requirement, and the consumers are also in search of the commodities. It is not that only marketers are always searching for this kind of information, and consumers are also equally searching for the right kind of products at the right place, at the right price, and things of that kind. Therefore, the consumers also need to gather information, assimilate that information, evaluate this information, and finally, with the budget constraints, what is the best product that they can buy. Therefore, the marketing and the consumer behavior go hand in hand. The marketers need to understand the consumer behavior, the consumers need to understand the knowledge of the markets. Therefore, the marketing is directly related to the consumer behavior.
Okay, Professor Reddy, let me ask Ramraju Garu, according to your knowledge is concerned, as far as your knowledge is concerned, what factors influencing consumer behavior to buy certain goods or services?
There are various factors influencing consumer behavior, Professor Anand Pawar. If you look at this slide, we can understand that there are four factors influencing consumer behavior: cultural factors, social factors, personal factors, and psychological factors. I would like to emphasize on the first two factors, that is cultural factors and social factors. First, we will look at social factors. Society, however, see, people live in groups. Man is a social animal. When a person is moving in society, that society will have its impact on him. So, social, first element in the social factor is social class. We all know that the social classes are three: upper class, middle class, and lower class. Now, the class in which a customer falls will have its impact on his buying behavior. If a person falls under the upper class, then definitely he becomes more quality conscious. If we come down, so a lower class person is more price conscious and less brand loyal. So, the type of class he is falling in will determine his behavior. The second element in social factors is formal groups and informal groups. People, as I have mentioned, live in groups, move in groups. People get together in a formal way, that is, in an organization whose structure is defined, the roles are mentioned. These are known as formal groups, like a Lions Club, a Rotary Club, the member of Doctors Association or Bar Association, all members of production department of an organization. These are formal groups. Now, all the members of these formal groups behave in a certain way. Then there are other types of groups in the society called informal groups. People, due to mind matching, due to various factors, people get together and they form into social groups. Now, these social groups, like social circles, they have their influence on individual behavior. And the last factor in social factors is, last element is family. The family from which a person has come is brought up determines his behavior. If he has come from an orthodoxic family, then that he purchases light colored dresses, and he would like to prefer to consume a very less spicy meal. Then he is most less inclined to the westernization process. If he comes from a nuclear family, which is an urbanized family, then the way he behaves is different. So, social factors like this will have their impact on individual behavior. If you look at cultural factors, obviously, man lives in a culture. Culture is learnt. There are two concepts in this learning culture: enculturation and acculturation. When a person learns his own culture, then that is what is known as enculturation. Let me emphasize on acculturation that is going on in India as of today. People are increasingly adopting foreign culture, Western culture particularly. And that foreign culture adaptation has created a big market for fast food, for pop music. So, there are and jeans, pants, etc. So, this acculturation is determining the way a particular consumer behaves. Now, in this way, there are various factors influencing consumer
behavior. Apart from this, Professor Reddy, is there any other factors which is influencing the consumer behavior?
Yeah, I would like to supplement to what Professor Ramraju was trying to say. If you look at the cultural factors, the culture itself is a dynamic.
Yes.
And it is enduring. When you say dynamic, what is today accepted as a culture, tomorrow it may not be accepted a culture. Over a period of time, the cultures also undergo change. Sometimes the change is dramatic. Yeah. and sometimes the change, we are not able to even, you know, guess that kind of change is likely to occur. Now look at the cultural change that's happening in the lifestyle of a woman. Few years ago, eating outside the family is considered to be something like a sin. 20 years ago, 10 years ago, a housewife always used to grumble when a male member eats outside the family. Now today, with the changing environment and all that, the same housewife complains, if you do not go out for a meal on say Saturday evening or maybe Sunday at the weekends, and what do they think about me? And they consider that our family is not an elite family. So the same woman over a period of time changing. As a result, the culture is not something like a static. It is enduring, number one. It is also dynamic. Therefore, as culture changes and our habits and our fashions undergo change, and our lifestyles are also undergo change. So culture itself is dynamic. Therefore, no culture is a permanent. As Mr. Ramraj was trying to say, that we are trying to imbibe others' cultures because we are emerging as a global society today. All these cultures, you know, were confined to our, you know, we are confined to our cultures before. Now we are trying to imbibe the others' cultures because we are talking in terms of the global village. Everything is changing. We need to change, otherwise we will be isolated. Therefore, probably over a period of time, we may have to practice the global culture. Wherever you go, the culture is more or less same. There may be minute differences in culture, and probably that may not influence the buying behavior to a greater extent. Apart from these cultural factors and social factors, one more point I would like to add as far as the social factor is concerned. The marriage is the oldest institution. When you look at the relationship that we talk about, husband and wife, it was given, you know, in the family hierarchy, father is undisputed leader. And then housewife is used to accept the leaders and all that. Now, housewife's role is also increasingly, I mean, becoming more and more important in the development of the family, because they are also educated, and to a greater extent, the woman contributes to a greater extent in the cultural development of the family. That's the reason we say mother is the first teacher in the family. So these are the social factors that also influence the purchase behaviors. And when you come to the social behavior again, we talk about the importance of the children. Now look at most of us, I have a perception that, you know, when you are buying some kind of food items like a dal, we feel that, you know, the housewife is the decision maker. But in reality, housewife is not the decision maker, but the child in the family decides what to cook and what not to cook in the family. And then father and mother become secondary, and the child is playing a greater role. Therefore, the child is asking for a particular dal. As a result, and the parents are expected to buy that, and they sacrifice their desires in order to fulfill the desires of the children. And this is how the social factors are also changing over a period of time. But 20 years ago, the children do not have this kind of decision-making role. So this is how the changing cultures and changing social factors also influence the buying behavior. Yes. Apart from this, we need to look at the personal factors. What are these personal factors? These are basically the individualized factors, something like age. The age differentials make the buying behaviors different. Look at a child. Child wants say chocolate. A grown-up adult probably looks at a burger he wants to consume. He looks at mostly foods that are available in the bakery shops and all that. So age is one criteria, and you know, children will prefer some kind of products. Elderly people prefer some kind of products. Senior citizens, after their retirement, their attention goes into the devotional things. They buy certain, you know, religious books and all that, and they spend more time in temples and in the social service and things of that kind. So age is one factor that influences the buying behavior of the people. Similarly, the life cycle is also equally important. It is connected to the earlier point. You know, in individuals' human life cycle, if you look at the various stages, starting from Baladasya to the Vrudhapadasya, or the child state to the final old age state, there are various stages that are evolved over a period of time. And depending upon the stage of this life cycle, and the purchase behaviors dramatically change. So this is one important aspect. Then the occupation which you belong to also will influence. For example, white collar job people, they prefer, you know, soft kind of products, maybe the dress materials that they buy. And look at the elite people, they prefer to buy a kind of soft toys for the children. And then, so education level and all these factors also influence. If you look at a blue collar job, they prefer dark colors, and then probably they buy kind of garments which long for longer time. Yeah. Which these are the kind of the purchases they indulge in. Then economic status is another important variable as a personal factor. So, which economic group that he belongs to, middle income group, higher income group, low, low middle income, higher middle income, and this is how we can categorize the people on the basis of the income status of the individual. That is one important aspect that we need to consider while examining the buying behavior. Next one is the lifestyle. I think Mr. Ramraj was also referring to this point some time ago. The lifestyle, urbanites will have a different kind of lifestyle compared to the rural people. A person who is coming from rural areas and settling down in urban area, though he is living in urban area, but still his consumption habits are traced back to the rural, they brought up. Therefore, this is how the lifestyles and the brought up and the children of the elite people and then rich families are their buying behaviors are distinctly different compared to that of people living in rural areas and coming from remote villages particularly. So, their life cycle is also important. Then apart from this, the individual personality of the individual itself. The personality means what do you like and what you don't like, and this comes probably from it's a hereditary factor, the gene factor. So, sometimes I come from a very remote village, naturally my brought up is different and soft spoken and things of that kind. As a result, people, they prefer a kind of products which are soft. So, personal factors also influence to a great extent their buying behaviors. Then comes your self concept and also the psychological factors. When you look at psychological factors, the motivation, what motivates you, and I think we need to look at a simple slide. Look at these psychological factors that influence the buying behavior. Motivation is one, perception is one. So, motivation is basically what factors motivate the individual to buy a particular product. And in this context, we would like to bring in the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Perception, how do you perceive a kind of information or a commodity? When you look at a product, you feel something, but some other person look at a product and then he feels something else. Yeah. Therefore, the perception also motivates the consumer. This is a psychological factor. Then comes learning our own experiences in the past. And this is what my experience is. Therefore, that experience you keep it as a backdrop, and then psychologically you feel when you are buying a product, that experience will motivate you. Then comes your kind of beliefs. The kind of belief, for example, women. And then what is your belief and what is your culture, what is your brought up about women and your perception about women. So, my belief is educated women will be able to bring up the child better than the uneducated. This is my belief. And similarly, when you talk about while buying a product, see, you look at the quality of the dress, and if it is a thick, you think that it's going to live for a longer. Yes. Yeah. And high priced commodities are considered as a high quality products. These are our beliefs. Yeah. So, on these beliefs also we try to influence the behavior. Then last one is attitude, and your attitudes which are framed already. That means how your predisposition is. That means you have already a certain attitude about a particular product. So, it is difficult to come out of that attitude all of a sudden. Therefore, even attitude influences to a greater extent with regard to the consumer behavior.
And let me thank Mr. Ramaraju for coming over here and sharing his views with regard to consumer buying behavior. And he enlightened our students to know about consumer buying behavior. Professor N.R. Reddy, thank you a lot for coming over here. Thank you very much.
మా కార్యక్రమాలపై మీ సూచనలు సలహాలు తెలియచేయండి. మీ సూచనలు సలహాలు తెలియచేయవలసిన మా చిరునామా